Hello, everyone. Welcome to our talk tonight. My name is Mike Hansen. I'm a public services librarian at the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. And this is the first in the Liz and Bob Frenkel Hiking and Environment Spring Lecture Series. Tonight's event is titled Local Beavers, How They Live and How We Live With Them. This is the first of three events, and you can find links to register for the next two events on the library's website calendar. Before we start the event, I wanted to quickly orient you to GoToWebinar, which is the platform we're using for this virtual event. You should see a small control panel on your screen, and if you don't see it, you can click on the orange button with a white arrow, and it opens and closes the control panel. When the panel's open, you should see a spot to click on to type questions that you'd like to ask. Please feel free to ask questions throughout the webinar, and we will hold these questions till the end, where we'll have some time to answer as many as possible. Now I'd like to introduce Dave Eckert, who will give some more information about the series and introduce tonight's speakers. Dave's the program chair for the Mary's Peak group of the Sierra Club, who's responsible for putting together tonight's program and many other great programs that we've had here. We appreciate all the great work he's done and the Mary's Peak group has done for us. Dave.
Okay, thank you. So you'll let me share my screen now, right?
Yes.
Okay, then people don't have to look as much at me.
Right.
My wife is telling me something is wrong, and I'm not sure what that means. Okay, show my screen. I think there's a lag on everything that's going on. Before you go, Mike, can you see my screen?
I see your screen. Yep, that's good.
Okay, Net, do you see my screen? Okay, good. All right. Well, welcome everybody. Liz and Bob Frenkel Hiking and Environmental Spring Lecture Series, sponsored by both the Mary's Peak Group of the Sierra Club and the Corvallis-Benton County Public Library. We have had the Spring Lecture Series since the early 2000s, and with the passing of Bob and Liz Frenkel, we decided to name it after them. If you did not have the honor of knowing Liz and Bob Frenkel, they were the environmental strategists and doers of Benton County, and we owe so much to them. And they have left a lot to us. So thank you so much. This presentation honors the Empanefu Kalapuya. This is we all who are in Corvallis and the Mary's River watershed. Live in the land of the Empanefu Kalapuya. It is known as Champanefu. And the Empanefu Kalapuya are alive and members of the Confederated Tribes of the Grand Ronde and the Confederated Tribes of Siletz Indians. And we would like to be able to do as much as possible to honor and the Kalapuya here. The Mary's Peak Group has been here. It was formed by the Frenkel family, and it inspires a culture engaged with flora, fauna, soil and water, and geological features, and we get people out there doing it, and we work on protecting it also. And for some reason now, my computer's froze. Okay, our first this webinar series came about because of I'll mention in a few minutes, but we have three webinars. This is our first one, it focuses on how beaver live and how we live with them locally here in Corvallis. The second one. Let's see if I can make this happen again, is the on April 28th, we hope you sign up for that, Opportunities for a New Beaver and Human Relationship. We have four different presenters that time, really looking more into the details of the opportunities we have to move into the future. And then the third one is on May 19th. And then we're looking at really the benefits, the global and local benefits of protecting beavers. So you can sign up for that also. This started when we made a video. You can watch anytime, a 9-minute video about, it's a story of two dams in Oak Creek, one human made and one beaver made. And we have two legendary OSU professor emerituses on there, Stan Gregory and Bob Beshta. And I it's definitely worth your 9 minutes. Go on YouTube, type in Damned Oak Creek, and it'll come right up. I hope you'll watch it. We're also having a t-shirt because we're really trying to promote the concept of Beavallis, taking Corvallis and putting beavers in there. And you can contact me at my email if you're interested in one. And we really want to get people thinking a lot about beavers. So in this first talk that we have Brian Bangs, who's an aquatic ecologist with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, where he works on beaver management and Willamette River non-game species conservation, and with a variety of non-game minnow species around the state, including the Oregon chub. Brian is relatively new to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service following a 16-year career at Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife. And if Brian looks familiar to you, it's because you've seen him on Oregon Field Guide, I believe, a number of times. And he's very popular on that. And I met Brian at Starker Arts Park, where he introduced to me and to a whole tour I was leading of Deniwi Creek to the Oregon chub and the resident Oregon chub that he has helped to bring back to life. It's a miracle story that Brian's worked on. And so Brian is the perfect presenter for this webinar series because he's had a lot of experience with beaver. Our second presentation today is with America McMillan, and talking, well, it's not just 10 years, but it turns out it's 15 years of observing beaver at Starker Arts Park. And for the last 15 years, I have seen America all over Corvallis working on the ground on all the great park areas that make Corvallis a wonderful place to live. I've noted she has been one of many great city employees that gets things done. And having watched the beavers at the same time at Starker Arts Park evolve as a community over the last 10 to 15 years, I knew that this story needs to be part of the first webinar in the series. And we need to know what is happening with beaver in one of our most popular public spaces. So when I called Jude Geist at Parks and Recreation, asked him who could best tell the story, without any hesitation, he said, America McMillan. So when I first asked her to present, she first hesitated. She later called me back to tell me she went back over to Starker Arts to crawl through the wetland underbrush to check up on the beaver. And after finding all these functioning beaver dams, she consented. So thank you, America. And our third presenter is Shay Steingass. And to figure out how to introduce Shay, because I'd never met her before, I had to go through her vita, which covers many, many pages, and all throughout her educational background, her various technical and professional jobs, her reams of publications, her professional presentations, reports, and outreach. But I decided to keep this short. So she is the new, relatively new, Benton County Environmental Project Coordinator. She does coordination and collaboration work on a variety of municipal projects and programs, including Prairie Species Habitat Conservation Plan, Benton County's Agricultural and Wildlife Protection Program, Stormwater Management, and Pollution Control. But she helps landowners learn to live and thrive with beavers as one of her major duties. Before that, she was the Marine Mammal Program Leader for the Oregon Department of Fish and Wildlife, supervising a 13-person collaborative state research and management program with a $900,000 annual budget. And she's currently also, in addition to being the Benton County Environmental Project Coordinator, a courtesy professor at OSU in Department of Fisheries and Wildlife, and she holds her master's and PhD from OSU in Wildlife Sciences. So with that, I didn't put her up there. There she is. We're going to save questions and answers until after all the presentations and put your questions as they come to you in the Q&A feature, not the chat. And we'll be answering the questions following all three presenters. So Mike, if you can get me off and I won't make any more mistakes. Thank you.
I was muted. I'm so sorry. I'm sitting here saying, okay, can you see my screen? And I just realized I was muted. Is it showing up okay?
Yes, it is. I see it. Thank you.
I'll take your fist as a heck yeah. Okay, well, thank you, David, so much for the nice introduction. My name is Brian Bangs, and I'm an ecologist with U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service. I live in Corvallis in Beavallis, and yeah, totally happy to be here today talking about beaver. I came to beaver by way of Oregon chub, and many of the habitats that we work in for Oregon chub are also beaver habitats. So my talk today is about how beavers function, or alternatively, if you like, how to beaver. So beavers. They're the largest rodent in North America, the second largest rodent in the world, second to the capybara. A lot of people locally kind of confuse beavers with nutria, which is on the bottom left-hand corner. Easy to tell them a difference because nutria have that nasty rat tail. Beaver typically large, 35 to 70 pounds at adult size. We also have muskrat locally. People kind of confuse beavers with muskrats. The tails are simply flattened in the other direction on the muskrat. They're a cool organism and something that's worth talking about to this group at some point. Historically, our beaver was not anything compared to the giant beavers that historically roam the landscape. This is a beaver, the historic prehistoric beaver, compared to the size of a person. So, historically, much larger in size. Today, there are two extant beaver, the North American beaver, and the European beaver. So we should note right off the get-go that North American and European beavers were almost hunted and trapped to extinction at one point. And of course, in the last 100 years or so, have really come back. The diet of beavers, they're 100% herbivores. I hear some people say sometimes, ooh, don't eat fish. No, muskrats occasionally do. Muskrats will eat, they'll have a varied omnivorous diet, but beaver do not. They typically feed on leaves, twigs, that cambrium, that inner bark of plant material. They'll also eat a lot of herbaceous plants, things like lilies and rushes, cattails. Willow, cottonwood, and alder are some of their favorite plants. They also, in environments where the ponds freeze over in the winter, they'll cache food underwater for winter. Beavers are awesome. They're highly adapted to their lifestyle. Almost every physical feature of the beaver is in some way an adaptation to the semi-aquatic lifestyle and to help them out. They have front feet, which are very dexterous, little fingers, and dexterous fingers to finely manipulate their surroundings. If you think about beavers are building beaver ponds and beaver dams, and they have to be able to work with sticks and move sticks around their hands. They have very dexterous front hands. Their hind limbs are large, they're webbed to help them swim through the water. They have split toenails, which they can use as combs to comb oil and natural oils through their hair to help them waterproof themselves. The tail, obviously, is there for propulsion to help them on land by helping them like lift themselves up and reach sticks and kind of elevate their body. It's fat storage. The beaver can also use their tail to slap the water as an alarm sound. And actually, juvenile beaver, as an aside, will slap the tail. They learn a lot of their behaviors from their parents and from the other beavers in their colonies. Apparently, juvenile beavers will slap their tails, that alarm sound, but they'll do it kind of like the boy who cried wolf. They'll just do it after fun. And so adult beavers will oftentimes ignore juvenile beavers and young beavers if they're slapping their tails because they're just doing it to get a reaction out of people. Their eyes have a nictitating membrane, basically a third eyelid, which can cover the eye and help them see underwater. Their ears and nose are highly developed, and they can close off when underwater to keep them from filling with water. One of the most curious features about them, in my opinion, is they have a second set of lips in their mouth. So you can imagine that if you're swimming underwater with a stick in your mouth. You don't necessarily want to get water in your mouth. So they have a set of lips behind their incisors that will close and keep water out of their mouth. It's bizarre. It's awesome, right? They also have a digestion in their gut. They have bacteria that help them aid in breaking down cellulose from wood. One of their curious adaptations is their teeth. Their incisors, those orange teeth on the above the skull here, grow throughout their life. And I've pulled one of this skull from my own collection. I pulled one of the teeth out to show that how long it is. The teeth will actually grow throughout their life. And as they're breaking and chipping down their teeth, biting through wood, they actually grow. So they have kind of an everlasting supply of incisor. Beavers live in colonies. And colonies are typically from up to about 12 individuals. Oftentimes they're formed of adults, previous year's juveniles, like age one beavers, and kids, age zero beavers. Oftentimes the young will remain with this family unit until they're about 2 years old, and they reach maturity at about 1.5 years old. This all depends the amount of beavers in the colony, and the amount of beavers that kind of stick to the colony. It depends on the habitat availability and the suitability of that habitat. Beavers can be really territorial to other beavers that come into their habitats. They can get in pretty aggressive, nasty fights with beavers that come in from outside. Adult beavers form long-term bonds and as adults. So beavers, I don't know if they necessarily mate for life, so quote unquote, but they do form pair bonds. They have about a 100-day gestation period, and kits are typically born in the winter, sometimes between January through March. Sizes of offspring will be from 1 to 8, average about 4 kits. Females will nurse kits and wean them about age 10 to 12 weeks. The kits themselves are not water resistant when they're born. That actually, the oils and the glands and the oils that are expressed from them begin to develop at about 5 to 8 weeks of age. So before that, they typically stay out of the water and just stay in the dens. And like I said before, the juveniles will slowly acquire adult behaviors as they live and work with the colony. This is a typical beaver lodge with some kits inside of it and beavers on the outside. There's three types of beaver lodges that we'll talk about here, but all of them kind of share similar features. So there's a freestanding lodge. You can imagine, for those of you who hike out of the Finley Wildlife Refuge, you know the Beaver Pond area out there. There's a big beaver lodge out in the middle of that pond, and it's a lodge that is freestanding, made of mud and sticks and stones, out in the middle of a water body. Another type of lodge would be what we call the bank lodge, and it's a lodge that is lodged. It's formed up against the side of a bank, made up of sticks and mud and that kind of stuff. But they use the bank as part of a burrow. With a lodge coming out of it. There's also stream burrows where there's no sticks and mud and stuff involved in it. There's just simply a tunnel that leads to a den that'll have an air vent and perhaps one or multiple entrances. All of these share similar features. They have a tunnel, an entrance, which is underwater, preferably underwater, or it should be underwater, which helps them hide from predators. The den itself is raised above in elevation above the water surface. So they have an air pocket where they can stay and live and have their kits and sleep and all that kind of stuff that's protected and out of the water. So all the dens, no matter what kind of style they are, all kind of share these similar features. Oftentimes when we're talking about beavers, we're talking about beaver dams. And it's one of their key characteristics and ecologically, one of the most important things about them. It's important to understand though that not all beavers make dams. Here in Corvallis, if you go out kayaking in the Willamette River, you'll see beaver chewed sticks everywhere. A beaver has eaten the bark off the stick like corn off of corn on the cob. And there'll just be a stick without any bark. And you'll find them all over the Willamette, around Corvallis, around Willamette Park. And those, beaver, you don't see beaver dams. You don't see beaver dens necessarily. They're bank-dwelling beavers. And they're beavers that have, dens with entrances under the water and banks and dens that go up then into the bank. So beavers primarily build dams as a way to avoid predators by increasing the water depth of the streams and the rivers they're living in. The predators of beaver are typically coyotes, cougars, bobcats, wolves, bears. I've read a story where some researchers We're seeing cougars dive 6 feet underwater to hunt beavers, which is incredible. They'll dive down to the bottom of these ponds for safety. They'll obviously enter their dens for safety to escape predators. Like I said before, they keep these lodge entrances underwater as a way of kind of hiding their dens and keeping themselves safe from predators. The beaver dams do a number of other things that help out the beavers. As beavers are dropping down sticks and branches, it allows them to float these branches out into the water and logs out into the water in areas where they can eat them in peace and not have to worry about predators hunting them on land. It increases their forage area. They'll kind of dig out these channels and runs laterally in off into the floodplain habitats away from the river. And this will allow them to quickly kind of scoot up and out into areas to find more areas to forage in these channels. Dams are constructed with whatever materials are available. I've seen them made out of Japanese knotweed. I've had them beavers pick up and incorporate my fish traps into their dams before. They'll use whatever is available, mud, stone, wood, herbaceous plants. Obviously, the kind of characteristic beaver dam is made out of sticks that they have chewed apart and built their dams. Oftentimes, there'll be like a main dam that is associated with their lodge, but they'll oftentimes build many dams throughout the landscape as they're moving out and finding more areas to forage in. Beavers choose dam based on several major elements. I cut it off here, it looks like. But the first one being topography of the landscape. Basically, they want to flood a large area, and they want the resultant dam to be several feet deep. They want the habitat to be generally low slope, where a flood won't blow out or destroy the dam. They're also looking for areas with food supply, areas that have abundant forage material adjacent to the flooded landscape, where they can forage and they don't have to go off into the woods to find food and perhaps be taken out by a predator. So if you look at a habitat like this, a raging stream, if a beaver were to smack a beaver dam down into a habitat like this, well, the resultant beaver dam wouldn't be that long, nor would it be all that deep. And you can imagine that come a winter storm, it may just blow out that dam and the beaver will lose protection that the dam was providing and also lose that ability to forage in the habitats created by that beaver dam. You look at the forest around here, and that while there are some small, twiggy kind of trees, and there's not a lot of herbaceous plants, and the wood that's here is mature. It's big, large trees. And so if a beaver wants to forage here, it's going to have to start dropping big trees to get to the bark and get to the needles or the finer stuff that it wants to eat. So it's not a really ideal spot for a beaver. And you look at a different location like this, a big flat open kind of plains area. Well, if a beaver smacks a beaver dam down here, it might increase the surface water area a bit, but it's going to have to make a big, tall, wide dam to make a big pool. And so there's plenty of herbaceous kind of rushes along here, plenty of forage material, aquatic plants in the water. Not a lot of herbaceous like sticks and that kind of stuff, but woody sticks in the landscape here that a beaver could collect and actually make its dam out. So location matters. If a beaver comes across something like this, a man-made road with a little tiny culvert in it, it might just say, oh my gosh, I've gone to beaver heaven, because this is the perfect spot for a beaver. You can imagine that all it takes is a beaver plugging up one little hole in this otherwise impervious dam and making an incredible habitat for itself behind it. And real pain in the butt for humans and infrastructure, but awesome if you're a beaver. And they'll oftentimes go to town and really make one heck of a dam. When they find a culprit, beavers are smart. They're smart animals. They're very choosy about where they're holing up and making habitats. I oftentimes tell people when they get beavers are problematic, they say, can we get rid of the beaver? And having a beaver is kind of like getting a mouse in the house. You can take one mouse out, but as long as it's still good mouse habitat, they're going to keep coming back. And so that's one of the problems with managing around beavers and what other people will be talking about later in the series. I want to talk briefly about the ecology of beaver dams. So they do a lot of ecosystem functions that we love, that we absolutely need on the landscape and as biologists. came to Beavers secondary from doing fish work. They do a lot of these processes which we need. Primarily, the thing that beaver dams do is slow water and retain water. And everything that is tied that I'm going to talk about here is due to that, slowing water down. So one of the things they do is decrease peak flows, decrease the magnitude of flood events. They expand the habitat area. So you can imagine the amount of wetted pond habitat. They're expanding that area both longitudinally, you know, they make a long pool, but also laterally, they're making a wide pool as well. And they're increasing the complexity of wetland habitats. They're increasing wetland area. Because they're slowing down water, they're allowing it to interact with the groundwater, and they're increasing this kind of groundwater recharge. You know, these landscapes around beaver dams and around rivers are much like sponges. And as water sits there, it's getting soaked up and increasing the amount of water on the landscape. It helps retain sediment. And so in areas that have channel incision, it's helping restore those habitats and increase this floodplain reconnection of the river to its floodplain. In many areas, especially in the Lehigh Valley, that's something that we are missing desperately. It helps moderate temperatures. It helps nutrient cycling, but basically getting nutrients to stick around in the environment and not get flushed downstream. And of course, it's creating a very important habitat for fish, amphibians, and wildlife. In general, we call these things riparian zones. Riparian zones are this area where the interface between terrestrial habitats and aquatic habitats. And beavers simply increase the complexity, the amount of riparian zones on the landscape. These are typically a minor part of the landscape, but they're one of the most highly productive and support the highest biodiversity on the landscape. So beavers on the landscape are awesome. We love them, we need them. I want to go through kind of a couple of examples here about the impact that beavers can have on an in-size stream. So if beavers put dams in on an in-size stream, which in areas that you know have had a lot of human use, oftentimes you'll have in-size channels. And if they put these in on, like you see on picture A here, they'll put them in and there'll be far too much energy in a system that's narrow and in size. And on picture B, you can see, oh, beaver dams. Flood came through and washed them out. However, the portions of the beaver dams that are left when they fail will shunt the water laterally and cause it to carve out the incised channels and allow wood to fall in and allow sediment to kind of enter the channel. And that sediment is quickly colonized by herbaceous plants and early cereal stage vegetation. What happens is it allows a lot of more material, forage material for the beavers to kind of use the next time. So in picture C, you see that, oh, the beavers have made dams again. These things will quickly fill up with sediment. The process keeps repeating itself. Dams blow out, the sediment, the beavers come back in, they repair the dams. And as you can see in picture B, eventually these will become stable and the beaver dams will stick around. These will begin to fill up with water, recharge the groundwater, and laterally expand the river into its former floodplain. This will create these kind of large ponds. Over time, these things will begin to fill in. All these ponds go through wetland succession. They'll become complex, braided structures. Over time, they will fill in, and beavers will have to move on and colonize new habitats. And of course, old beaver ponds will fail. They'll eventually evolve, and the process will begin. It will start over again. But this is the natural process. They create these very messy floodplain forests. And for those of you who know what the land looked like before European colonization, it was a mess. It had lots of these messy floodplain forests. In a lot of areas, this is kind of the ideal that we want to get back to. Beavers, we call them a keystone species. They're environmental engineers. And we call them a keystone species because they play this crucial role in biodiversity. Innumerable species in the land require on beavers and beaver habitats to go through their life history. So while they can cause a lot of problems on the landscape, they're absolutely necessary to keeping and retaining our biodiversity. I work with Oregon chub, and that's the picture in the foreground here. But for those of you who care about salmon, salmon utilize these habitats for rearing, and things like western pond turtles or amphibian species, bird species, all of them require, many of them that is, require beaver habitats to be successful. So that's the end of my presentation. I'll leave you here with this hilarious comment. I put my email address up here, and if folks have questions and they don't get answered tonight, please go ahead and email me and I'll try to get back to you. So with that, thank you so much.
Thank you, Brian. And next up is America.
Hello.
America. Go ahead.
All right. Good evening. And thank you for Dave for inviting me to this talk. As he said, I work for the City of Corvallis in the Parks and Recreation Department, and I've actually been here 15 years this month. And the wetland habitat out at Bruce Starker Arts Park has kind of got a little special place in my heart. Oh, I'm sorry, my presentation. Oh, there we go. All right. So I'm assuming a lot of people know where Bruce Starker Arts Park is, but if you do not, Highway 20 Philomath Boulevard is right here. Corvallis Country Club is right here. Safeway on 53rd Street is there. So Bruce Starker Arts Park is on 45th and Country Club. And originally Bruce Starker Arts Park was this area here. It's got the amphitheater and a pond and a little bit of landscaping and the Sage Community Gardens and then the second section is right in here, which was formerly known as Sunset Park. I believe about 5 years ago it was decided that those two parks should just be one. So I do apologize to everyone if I refer to the area that I'm talking about as Sunset Park. It is because it's ingrained in my head and I'm working to change that. So this is the little polygon I showed you, so that was second. This is an old photo from probably back in the 80s. This park originally was acquired in 1966. And in the 80s, when softball was the recreational sport of choice, they put in these three softball fields, this one here, and this third one here. It's this third one that's gonna be how we see a lot of changes that happen out there. This little stem of the creek originally came through and went across. And so they decided, well, we're gonna build a ditch. We're gonna divert the water over here and go into Denawi Creek. That didn't work so well. This ball field was wet until the 4th of July. They couldn't get on it to play games until then. And so sometime in the early 2000s, money was raised through grants, and the sunset side of Starker Park was completely revamped. They left the ball fields. They moved the community garden that was down here in this little triangle. They added what is now the playground and a picnic shelter and restroom. And then that was phase one of the project. Phase two, they rebuilt this wetland. And that is where we are gonna focus our beaver talk today. So here is what we have today. We've got this wonderful boardwalk that goes all the way through, and then it turns to a gravel, and then it comes back to boardwalk, and you can get this great little nature hike in. It's very easy, it's very accessible, and you get to see a lot of fun and interesting things. I'm going to go back to the last slide. So these trees here are still there today. So they're here now. So that gives you a little bit of a better reference. You can see how much this is more riparian, and you can see why that ball field was always wet. I apologize. Okay. Oh no, I ended it. Nope, hold on. I am so sorry, I pushed the wrong button. We'll get there. I play in landscapings, not on computers. All right, here we go. Here are a couple of our beaver dams, and you can see that the older trees are kind of taking it in the shorts because they get to be, they have soggy, wet feet all the time, but they will support more wildlife as time goes on. I went out there 1st of February and was amazed at how much recent beaver activity I found. Lots of little trees that were cut down. This one hadn't been taken away, but it was cut in half. This little beaver dam kind of surprised me when I found it. And then you can see where this little guy must have been a favorite for them to come back to because they keep nibbling him off. Shrubs doing what shrubs do, and they continue to throw out new branches. Everybody's happy with that one. So where are the dams? When I went out there, I discovered we have 8 dams, and 6 of which I found recent activity around. So parking lot, our boardwalk. So this dam here and this one up here are the ones that I consider our oldest dams. Those were the first ones built after the wetland area was completed back in, I think that was completed in 2008. This one up here has created this lovely little pond that there's pretty much always water in. And then this one is responsible for this larger ponding area that you can go out there any time of the year and see ducks and nutria and all sorts of things. Then I believe these secondary dams came in, this one here and this one here, and just to kind of keep the area the way the beavers want. But within the last 5 years, the dams over here have gone in. At times I wonder how this section of the boardwalk is not completely flooded out, just because you can go out there late season and the water is right up almost to the top of the boardwalk. This dam here has created this little itty bitty pond that's just kind of starting. It's still a neat little area. And as I was walking around, I discovered there's a tree over here that had gotten gnawed off. So I dug through the bushes and I found this little dam I didn't know was there. Now these little marks are all just kind of where they kind of are. They're not absolutely perfect. And then in about 2010, early 2010s, we had 3 really wet springs in a row. And we noticed that because of this dam here, we were having a little bit of water backflow, and it was backflow kind of filling up onto the ball fields. And that was causing some issues with mowing and getting the ball fields ready for the softball programs. So we called somebody from ODFNW. A biologist came out and remarked at the amazing wetland we have and what we could do for kind of diverting some of that water, controlling the pond level, to put in a beaver deceiver. And I'll talk about that in a little bit. So, you know, as Brian said, there's a lot of other wildlife that is involved with a beaver dam and the ecology that they produce. I didn't notice them this year because I didn't go out there, but in winters past, we've seen some of the snowy egrets that just kind of live out there, great blue heron, this wonderful, beautiful little dragonfly, this fun little praying mantis was just sitting on the boardwalk saying hi, and I can't even count how many clutches of ducks have been raised on that pond, and they've always been fun to see. And I apologize, I don't know my birds very well, but these 3 little guys were out here having a great time. I think they were going for something in the mud there. So that's just fun to watch because you go out there, you hear the birds singing, and you really don't feel like you're in the middle of the city anymore. So here's the beaver deceiver. This is a very, very simplistic drawing of what a beaver deceiver is. Basically, it's a pipe in the ground that has a cage around it so the beavers can't block it off, and it kind of pushed through the dam and diverts some of the water. This is just very simplistic. It's a lot more difficult to install one than it looks. This is a little bit more, this one I did get off of the ODFNW's website, and it gives you all of the dimensions and how to build it and how to protect it and how you can set the level of where the water comes in at, so you can maintain a pond, a significant pond level, and the water will just flush through this pipe, come on down past the dam, and continue going downstream. It worked quite well for, I think, one or two seasons. We never went back and cleaned it up and had it going right. So this was kind of a neat system to build, and the person from ODF&W was extremely nice and talked us through how to do it. This is what our beaver deceiver looks like. It is absolutely no longer functional. It's full of reed canary grass. There's a few posts left up in the ground, but you can see right along here, there's more of the beaver dam. So whether it was really truly functional for us, if we would have gone out and checked it a little more often, it probably would have worked, but I think we put it in just late enough that we never actually got it to work properly. So this is not a beaver. As it was mentioned earlier, we have so much nutria out there that people are constantly talking about, oh, I saw a beaver out there. Like, are you sure? It's probably a nutria. I've been out there quite a bit over the last 15 years, and I think maybe two or three times I've actually seen a beaver. And usually if I do, it's a fleeting moment where they're kind of swimming away. And because beaver are so much bigger and swim differently than the nutria, once you've seen both of them swim, you realize what you're looking at, but it does take that. So yeah, nutria have moved in. They're kind of doing what nutria do as well, but it's the beavers that have made that wetland out at Starker Arts Park just absolutely amazing and beautiful, and we're very lucky to have them there. So since I don't have a camera and you couldn't see me, I'm here with the orange arrow pointing at me. This is my husband and my friend and her husband at an OSU football game a few years ago. We were all four proud OSU graduates, and once in a while, you know, we gotta do the other beaver thing too. So thank you so much for having me. And if you have any questions, please write it in there, or go ahead and email me, or give me a call, and we can chat or meet out there even maybe. So thank you very much and have a wonderful evening.
Great, thank you, America. Next we have Shay, who will be presenting. And send that over to you.
Wonderful, can you hear me?
We hear you, yep.
Okay, great.
Thanks.
Let me get her up and cross my fingers here. Is there a way to close the, oh no, you're not seeing that, so I think we're okay. Okay, well, hello everybody. My name is Sheanna Steingass, and I'm very happy to be here in my fairly new position as the Environmental Project Coordinator for Benton County Public Works. I was really excited when Dave invited me to talk today because, again, this is one aspect of my job that I'm very excited about. And I've really enjoyed just learning as well, and I really enjoyed learning from the previous two presentations. So my talk today is a bit of a quick tour around beavers in Benton County and how we work with them. I'm still learning in my position, and part of the really great parts of my job is that I get to learn about the amazing wildlife and ecology of Benton County, and beavers are a really important aspect of that. So part of my job as Environmental Project Coordinator is to make sure that we're creating great things for Benton County citizens, but also protecting and looking after our local wildlife and plants, which I think is very important. Relationship, not only in Benton County, but a species with beaver is what I would say is a complicated one. beaver were heavily extirpated in the 20th century and prior to that, and they are essentially a success story. They're a species in recovery. I found this front page of the Corvallis Gazette Times a while ago, and I thought it was so great in terms of picturing how we live with beaver in Benton County. It's an article just about how a tree was felled in part because of some beaver gnawing that weakened it, and how that can affect our roads and, you know, public safety. But also, we have the cute little weather beaver down below telling us what our weather is going to be like. So beavers represent many different things based on who you're asking and people's perspectives. And I think that's one of those really interesting aspects of them as a species. And part of our complicated relationship with beavers has to do with their amazing biology. And they are rodents, and that does mean that their teeth grow continually, but they also have just some other interesting aspects to them. So they're extremely large. A 60-pound rodent is big. They can be up to 4 feet long, which is also just, it's really hard to picture unless you're up close to one to really appreciate how large they are. The interesting thing about beaver that I think biologically sticks out is just their bite force and their capacity to use those amazing teeth that they have. So their bite force is estimated at about 550 to 740 newtons, and which is pretty high up there. And there's a couple other important aspects that make that really unique. And part of it is instead of, you know, putting all their bite force throughout their mouth and all their teeth, it's really directed towards those front incisors. And that's why their bite packs such a punch, because all of that pressure essentially is on two very small surface areas. The other thing that's really amazing about beaver is just their muscle power behind this bite. So if you look at the skull on the right, that's actually a tiger. And we think of tigers as these amazing predators that can really, you know, take down almost anything. And that hole in the skull that you see in the middle and right images is called the zygomatic process or the zygomatic arch. So I'm a biologist by trade, so I have to fit this in. That arch or process you can feel on your own face if you touch your cheekbone, and you follow that bone all the way back to your ear. So that bone contains all of the muscles that give your jaw its bite force. And typically in species, the bigger that arch is, that hole, the more muscle power is in that bite. And so when you look at that beaver, which is a rodent, compared to a tiger skull, you really get a picture of how important that bite is for the survival of beaver as a species. So keep that in mind. So part of my job has been actually to think of the very complex relationship we have with beavers and really kind of establish our relationship with them as a community. And so I'm working recently with our GIS engineering technician, Deanne, and we are trying to find really as much data as we have on beavers throughout Benton County, and hopefully trying to gain some more data in the next year. So you'll see that the data points here represent several years, starting in 2003. The large yellow dots there were beaver locations. Some additional sites were marked in 2015, and the affected watersheds were marked as well with the green lines there. And in 2021, there was a few more data points. And actually, I got to take a tour of some beaver locations this past week, including a Benton County resident that was kind enough to send us information on some beaver activity that was happening. And it was very interesting because by the time he had sent us the email and a picture of a tree that had been taken down by a beaver, we got out there and that tree had already been cut up and drug into a ditch. So all of that activity can take place overnight. And that's why monitoring these types of situations and beaver engineering is important, because it allows us to know what might be a problem or what's going on. And of course, as everyone said, we don't want to forget one of the most important beavers, which is OSU in Corvallis. So I'm a proud beaver as well for over a decade now. So back to, what is the role of beavers in our community? And it really depends who you ask. And as county representatives, we work with all groups in Benton County. So for the watershed councils that we work with, beavers are actually really valued as partners in wetland restoration. There's a lot of riparian and wetland repair work going on. And part of that is historical removal of beaver dams and simplifying of the environment that's led to things like erosion and scouring that actually is a detriment to biodiversity in the county. That work is going on right now in multiple locations, and it's very cool. For municipalities or county organizations, beaver can cause flooding or things like blockages and culverts, as America and Dave mentioned. For biologists, beavers are amazing ecosystem engineers that are living in a very complex landscape of human use. And lastly, for property owners, beavers can be destructive, and they can chew down trees or cause flooding that can be detrimental to property. And we serve all of these groups, so you can see how complex this picture is. And that's why communication and being open-minded is really important. There's, a bit of a situation that I like to call ecosystem engineers versus engineers, because beavers often impact our infrastructure. So there's multiple ways that we respond to reports of beaver activity or things like flooding. So the first thing we'll do is go assess what's going on. Just like I did last week, I went out and looked at the site, and we saw that it could be a problem in the future, but it's nothing to worry about right now. So we'll probably go out in a few months and then probably this winter just to see how things are going. We monitor beaver activity really close to our roads, culverts, and other infrastructure. There's a number of people that do that type of work, and we all just stay in communication. And then our first option, if there is a problem, if we do have a road flooding, is to try and mitigate for those hazards. We can remove a dam, but that attraction is still there. And that's because beavers are, when they hear running water, they think that they need to take care of that. I think they think they're fixers. So you can remove a blockage from a culvert, but culverts are pretty loud, for one thing. And so if you don't come up with a long-term mitigation option, then that problem is going to pop back up again, either from the same beaver or a different group. Eventually, it's just going to come back. So Benton County, we recognize the importance of beaver and the key role that they play in supporting our stream ecosystems and fish and wildlife habitat. And we also recognize they provide a host of ecosystem benefits that also benefit humans, ultimately. And as the county, we partner with many organizations, including the Mid-Willamette Beaver Partnership and local watershed councils who incorporate beavers as partners in wetland restoration. So all of our work just really feeds into those perspectives, and I'm really excited about these types of movements, understanding the whole ecosystem perspective in terms of finding long-term solutions for people and beavers. So one aspect of my job that ties into things like property protection as well. In this, the regard of beavers is the Agricultural and Wildlife Protection Program. So the AWPP is a grant program created to help Benton County residents protect livestock and crops while coexisting with wildlife, and to use non-lethal deterrent methods to prevent conflicts with wildlife. So typically this program has people doing things like building lambing sheds or fences or deterrents for things like coyotes or foxes to protect their livestock. But there's also a really important aspect of this program that is emphasized specifically for properties experiencing damage or flooding from beavers. And it is a major part of the AWPP, and we really hope to have more applicants in the future. So if you are a Benton County resident that has property that is impacted by beavers, meaning crop damage or flooding, I really encourage you to look up the Ag and Wildlife Protection Program. Typically, we have very specific application windows for residents to apply. However, we have funds specifically set aside for beaver-related damage. And those grants can be applied for any time of the year. And I really hope to do more outreach on this side of the program, because it's really exciting how that ties into the work all of our partners are doing in terms of sustainability and working with wildlife and ecosystems. So as America mentioned really, really eloquently, all of these systems do need to be maintained to some respect, and that really differs. These are just some examples of what the city or county can do to mitigate for beaver impacts, as well as private citizens. So paint that is embedded with sand can actually prevent chewing, or wire guards can prevent tree damage as well. There's also all of these wonderfully named devices like the Beaver Deceiver, the Caster Master, diversion dams, culvert fences, or even just grates for the short term, that essentially create a way that we can either level water levels around a beaver dam or protect certain pieces of infrastructure from being directly clogged. So the AWPP has more resources on this. And again, I really encourage you or anyone that has some of these issues to look this program up and think about applying for deterrence. Just a few additional resources for folks. We work with a lot of different organizations, as I mentioned. These are pretty prevalent wildlife resource programs, such as the Beaver Institute. We worked with those folks to get some mitigation devices installed several years ago. They have a wonderful website with specs for all the deterrent devices. You can get professional advice. There's trainings you can take, which I think sound really, really cool. They actually can show you how to install these devices. And they have hundreds of resources like books and webinars and papers that you can look into. Beavers, Wetlands, and Wildlife is another great group, and they have some great resources on protecting trees and plants. And then the other three, the Beaver Coalition, I think it's Beaver Works Oregon and Beaver State Wildlife Solutions are also, those are all resources. There's, small businesses essentially that can help you deal with some of these issues that you may have on your property and still live with and enjoy the busy little beavers in your backyard. So I think that's just really great that there are so many efforts like this out there. And I think that's one of the things that makes Benton County special, is that we really go above and beyond to manage the county in a way that's very holistic and considerate. And so that's about all I have to say. I am still learning, and I really look forward to doing more of this work in the future. So As our slogan says, we're at your service every day. Please contact me if you have questions about county-related issues or infrastructure issues, or you're interested in the AWPP and grant funds related to that. Just happy to be here today. Thank you.
That's great. Thank you, Sheanna. Now we have time for Q&A. If others could come and join me on the screen again, Gabriel. And we do have a few questions. Thank you, Brian. So one of the questions probably would be directed towards you, Brian, because it came during your presentation part. The question was, if water flow is slowed, what happens to the water temperature? Or if others have answers too, they can.
No, that's a great question. So water is slowed, and obviously in some situations, if the water was shallow, it could be warm, right? One of the things that happens in beaver dams, especially the ones we have locally, are that the water is actually slowed down enough that it begins to stratify. And so that you have a top level epilimnium of the water that is quite warm, warmer than fish prefer in most cases. But below that, you'll have a kind of a reservoir of cool water underneath that. And so it's you get this kind of stratification that occurs in the beaver ponds. Yes, sunlight warms it, especially in these big, broad beaver ponds. But the water will also frequently interact with the groundwater. There'll be a lot of groundwater exchange. And as it moves through the through the beaver dam and through the cobbles and substrates around that, cool down as well.
Thank you. So you have a question about the about Starker Arts Park and the nutria. So the question is, do the nutria outcompete the beavers? How do they get along? Do they have to compete for resources?
Honestly, I would have to say they are living together just fine. They're everywhere. The nutria are everywhere out there, but we clearly have active beavers. So I don't know from a biology standpoint if they're clearly sharing that ecosystem. So I couldn't tell you for sure, but they're out there. They're having fun.
Brian, what is your thought on that?
Yeah, I have heard that nutria will compete with a beaver, but there are a number of habitats around here, like Starker Arts Park, where you'll see them coexisting. Beaver obviously are eating woody sticks and twigs and falling trees like you see out there. Nutria aren't doing that. They're going for more of those softer herbaceous plants. So there, maybe there's a bit of a they're kind of compartmentalizing themselves off. Certainly the beavers are going to be eating herbaceous plants as well. But if they can, they maybe in some habitats they can coexist.
Great. So there's a question about beaver population management. Sort of, are they protected? Are they allowed to be hunted? Or I guess killed. Anyone know the status of that?
Yeah, I'll take a swing at that one. Because it's not a fun topic, right? I don't want to go up here and say, we love beaver, obviously, but beaver in state of Oregon are classified as a predatory species mostly for the damage they can do to property and the damage they can do to agricultural crops. And so, yes, they can be hunted and trapped and removed from habitats and obviously are. As a fur-bearing species, they can be targeted by trappers for their hides. And when people do have to get a license for that and report those back to the state. The numbers that are trapped for fur are fairly low, but it's still happening.
If I can chime in, our next webinar will be covering an in-depth answer to that question. because we'll have two presenters who are presenting, who have written new legislation that hasn't gotten out of committee yet, but we're hoping it will, and that will change. So they'll go into more in depth on that, and so please come back for the second webinar.
It's nice to see that we are in Benton County, at least try to manage non-lethal management of beavers. So that's, I'm glad to hear you've said that, Sheanna.
Yeah, and I should mention too, you know, we do the best on our end, but some decisions are totally up to the property owners as well. Mm-hmm. We don't interfere with that. But I think it's great that we have that resource of the AWPP for folks who want options.
And a lot of agencies, a lot of our state and federal agencies around the state are trying to make that easier, trying to make those conditions easier to get people to use non-lethal management for beavers. So there are other options available and make those options more appealing to landowners so they don't immediately go out and try to lethally remove them. There was a program up in Portland moving beavers out of the storm drain networks up there onto BLM property where they had been extirpated with the idea that take them out of player areas where we really can't have them flooding Portland and into areas where they can actually do good and we know that they're missing. So it's slow road, but people are interested in making it easier for landowners.
If I can say one more thing is that we'll be going over this on the second webinar, having Jacob Shockley coming in, and then Kathleen Wesley, and they're going to be talking to, you know, when and how to implement certain components or elements to help control or mitigate some of the beaver activities, and that will include long-term maintenance too. And so it's not just you put them in, then you walk away. But, you know, it does take maintenance because beavers are persistent. Even when you remove them, there's other beavers. And like Brian had mentioned earlier, when they see a good place, other beavers will see a good place too. So there is some complexity to it. And I think we're all on a learning curve with this, both from a management perspective and a legal perspective. Any more, Mike?
Yeah, we have a question for America. I think others could answer this too, because it's about Steingass Park again. And I think pretty much everyone's been there. So have you noticed beaver dams downstream from the Steingass Park area and Dunaway Creek?
Yes, we've seen quite a few just on the other side of 45th Street. Public Works maintains that section, and Ted Hart with the city maintains a lot of the other streams, so he would know where there would be more out there. But definitely, we've seen them right along there, all along Starker. I would venture to say they're probably all through that wonderful riparian area, wherever you've got enough trees and the water flow.
Okay, I'll say a few words. Yeah, I just did a walkthrough, and there had been beaver dam. I haven't seen any beaver dam down there now. And I think there's differences of philosophy amongst different departments. On the mitigation issue. So we may have some good education and thought and philosophy discussions interdepartmentally. Because Shay, I think you were the one who gave that wonderful slide showing that different people have different perceptions, and in the municipality, the very top priority for stream management is a rapid response stormwater conveyance system, and that's not what Beaver contribute to? So there is a dichotomy there in a concept of how do you mesh ecological practices with a rapid response stormwater conveyance system, meaning get the water out as fast as you can. Don't want any hell or high water. And beaver dams don't match that mentality or that philosophy, I should say. And so we as a human culture have to figure out some way to match our different sets of needs into one. I think that's what Shay and America and Brian have been spending their careers doing. And I really applaud them.
So another question here, does anyone have an estimate of the beaver population in Benton County? No. They seem pretty shy and hard to count.
And it's a primarily nocturnal species. They're hard to count. They're wary of people. You know, I've been asked to come out to many properties where people say, oh, we don't have beaver here. And then you go and walk a stream and sure enough, you start finding sticks. There are clearly beaver chewed sticks and saying, well, one was here. You know, so we don't have enough.
Yeah, you know, and I think that's coming into this job. One of my first questions was, what do we know about beavers in Benton County? And what we can do is count dams, you know, within our jurisdiction and, you know, private property owner reports. But, you know, like Brian said, there could be up to a dozen beaver per complex or dam or lodge. And if something's on private property, we may not know about it. So, beaver are just one of those species that, since they're not listed, the priority is really on, I guess, understanding how they intersect with humans and how to deal with that, rather than having the really hard data of, you know, how many are there. And that's not just Benton County, that's really across North America and in the US.
If we wanted to see a beaver, have a beaver spotting, when is the best time to go? Middle of the night, or would dusk or dawn work?
I would go dusk and onward and go right down towards the river. There were so many beaver chewed sticks out there, you know, Willamette Park area, or maybe, you know, one of the boat ramps. You know, they're wary though. They're going to stay away from you.
Should I add, don't bring your dog?
Does Benton County have partnerships with other counties in managing beaver population, or not just population, but activity?
Yeah, well, Brian might have some additional info. As a county, I think our partners are really within, they're kind of interjurisdictional in terms of agencies. So Fish and Wildlife Service, NAMPS, ODF&W, all those great watershed councils. To be honest, I think a lot of municipalities are just getting grips on the whole, complex issue of working with beaver within their areas. And so I don't know if there's a ton of crosstalk. I don't know how many counties have a position like mine where this is a solid part of their job. So I'm pretty lucky.
So Shay, doesn't the Mid Willamette Beaver Protection, they're having like a seminar coming up and they give us a bit of funding for private landowners to do something? And I know something came across my screen today and I didn't have time to look at it, but yeah, looks interesting.
What I'm aware of right now that they're doing, which is very cool, is a series of surveys to people in different industries to talk about their relationship with beaver and how their industry deals with them. And that's going to be an incredibly important result to have, because we'll get a picture of where public attitudes and issues are with beaver, which we really don't have right now on a regional ecological scale. So I think they're having a discussion group where folks are invited, but I'm not sure the mechanism for that. Okay. Who's invited?
All right, that is about all the questions we have tonight.
This is great, Mike and Shay and America and Brian. One thing I didn't mention at the beginning when I couldn't make my system work and was the role of Randy and Pam Comalillo, who are our Beaver heroes in Benton County, who have really, maybe I'm wrong, but I think they've been leading the charge and getting all of us together in different ways and actually helping to found the program that I think Shay works on and protecting not only Beaver, but some other animals that have been misunderstood, let's just say, and abused a bit. And they helped me a lot on finding each of you and helping to come up with topics and how to encourage you to speak today, which didn't take much, but I didn't know most of you, you know, in advance. So and Randy will be one of the speakers at the next time. So I want to have my hat off to both of them. What I'm really encouraged by is how people are starting to work together now rather than in silos, and seeing people really, coming together and trying to figure out how to resolve some of these seemingly intractable differences of opinions and techniques, and coming to some rational approach so that we can live a little more in harmony with Beaver, and therefore Beaver will help us too. So any final words for each of you? Go Beavs.
I would just say that if you've got issues with any kind of wildlife, reach out. When we were having issues with that flooding, we called ODF&W and they sent somebody out and really explained it and were really beneficial and helpful. So if you've got an issue, talk to somebody and, you know, contact one of us and we might be able to direct you into the right way, but don't get frustrated and don't try to tackle it, any problem like with wildlife alone.
Yeah, right. Great. Well, in our next show, we will be going more in depth with Jacob Shockley and Kathleen Wesley into some of the local, very specific areas. You'll learn some specific techniques, and then we'll have the two people talking about legislation that we have to have if this is all going to work. I mean, because the current laws are a little rough. They're written in a different era and in a different mindset. And I would recommend you looking at the Damned Oak Creek video. And here's a t-shirt that we have, Beavallis, Oregon. We want people to know this is Beavallis, Oregon. make everybody proud, not just of the sports beavers, but of the fauna also. So I want to applaud each of your work, Shay, Brian, America, and I'm grateful for you being where you are within the respective government agencies doing the work of angels, and Mike for pulling us all together and making this happen. Thank you very much, and I hope to see you all on April 28th, and we'll take this to a different place also. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a good night.
Good night.